Congratulations to all the students who are going to start their studies from a Canadian university. And because I don't want to be biased, please allow me to say congratulations to anyone else who has gone back to university or to a college. And for this video, guys, we are going to focus on studying and working in Canada, putting a very keen eye on the difference between authorized breaks and scheduled breaks. Stay with me. Hello guys, welcome back to Akot TV, and if you're new here, my name is Akot. And on this channel, we talk a lot about immigration and opportunities from different countries. And sometimes, we just live life. If that sounds really nice on your ears, then please subscribe to Akot TV. And if you don't have anything to say, just comment positive vibes only. So guys, like I mentioned earlier, working and studying in Canada. And if there's anything I would like you to get from this video, this particular one, is the difference between scheduled and authorized breaks. If you can get the difference between those two, it will save you a lot of trouble. Like seriously, it's gonna save you from a lot of trouble. Okay, so ideally, like any other university, not Canada alone, but once you join a university as an international student, there'll be a leeway for you to start working. So you'll have the privilege of working part-time, and you'll also have the privilege of working full-time depending on the course you're doing and at what level you are at. So let's talk about one, two, three, four, a few things, and then somewhere along the video, I will tell you the difference between scheduled breaks and authorized breaks. And this is very important. You need to watch this video to the end so that you understand what it is. And once you start your studies in Canada or outside of Canada, because what is happening currently is Canada allows students to start studying while in their home country. So that means you can start your studies now for the fall semester and then continue studying in your home country until the following year in April. But if you're doing a course which is just 8 months only, then you are allowed to take up your course for the whole duration in your home country, and that will not affect your postgraduate work permit at the end of it all. So in case there's anyone who does not understand what postgraduate work permit is, this is what it is. When you move to Canada as a student, you're going to study for a course. So maybe it may be undergraduate, or you could start studying at a master's level or at a PhD level. So what happens is, of course, you'll be given rules and regulations which will be attached to your visa, study permit. Okay, you'll have your rules and regulations. So you have to take your course, finish, and then when you finish, you'll be given 2 years to work in Canada. So if your course is between 8 months and 1 year, you'll be given one extra year to continue working in Canada. But if your course is 2 years and more, you'll be given 3 years worth of postgraduate work permit. So postgraduate work permit allows you to stay and work in Canada legally. And the duration of your postgraduate work permit depends on the duration of your course. Postgraduate work permit is exempt of LMIA. Again, for the sake of those who may not understand the meaning of LMIA. So LMIA means that when you get a job offer from a Canadian employer, if you're moving to Canada through express entry, PNP, and all those many other methods for you to move to Canada, then you will need what is called an LMIA. So an LMIA basically means that your employer can prove to the Canadian government that they need you to work for them, and also prove that they cannot find anyone else in Canada who can do the job that you're going to do. So that is what is called LMIA. But if you study in Canada and you get postgraduate work permit, then it means for whatever job you will get, whatever kind of job you will get, your employer will be exempted from producing an LMIA. So that's a big advantage if you ask me. But remember, if you're a student in Canada and you're registered in just a general program, nothing professional, then at the end of your course, you will not be eligible for postgraduate work permit. But again, everyone has their own plans when they move to Canada. Not everyone who moves to Canada as a student has the intention to settle in Canada. There are people who will go to Canada, study, and then once they are done with their education, they move back to their country or any other country of their choice. But if your case is different and you're moving to Canada as a student with the intention of settling in Canada, then you must register in a professional course that takes at least 1 year and above. Or if it has to be short, then at least 8 months and above and nothing below that. When you start your course, depending on the program you'll be doing. For undergraduate, you'll find that your institution demands that you must take 3 courses for you to qualify as a full-time student. But you find that you may take those 3 courses and then when you're starting your semester, you're a full-time student. Then somewhere along the way, you realize that the 3 courses are weighing too much on you. Then you make a decision and you drop 1 course. Now, if you drop 1 course, that means you're left with 2. And if you're left with 2 courses, that means now you do not qualify as a full-time student and that takes you back to part-time student. And what will that do? That is going to affect your postgraduate work permit at the end of your course. So make sure when you're studying, you always qualify for a full-time status international student. And how do you qualify as a full-time student? Most of the time, you'll find that you just need to take 3 courses, which if you're coming from Africa, should be manageable. I'm not saying that if you're not coming from Africa, then you will not be able to manage. No, I'm just saying that in Africa, we are used to hardships. So 3 courses, and in our universities, we take 5, 6, 7 courses. So 3 courses would be a walkover. I'm not sure about other countries, but Africa, we can endure. During your program, you must not take long breaks. I mean, if you have to take a super long break, then make sure it's just 4 months maximum. If you take more than 4 months of break from your course, now that is going to bring you trouble. And it's also going to affect your postgraduate work permit at the end of your course. It is actually advisable that you take a maximum of 150 days of break only. 150 days only. So if you're planning to go on holiday and just enjoy yourself, you go back to your country, have fun, say hello to your countrymen, and then you go over the 150 days, now you'll just be beckoning for trouble. Trouble. Come get me. Come get me. And believe you me, trouble will get you. Most universities will not give breaks for master's level. Scheduled breaks for master's level almost in all universities does not exist. You see, in some of our countries, you realize that if you're doing your master's, then there are breaks, normal breaks. But Canadian universities, most of the time, if you're taking a master's program, they do not give breaks. You just study through. But of course, Christmas and public holidays, you don't get to go to class. But any other time, you're going to class every single day except for weekends. But again, Saturday depends on your professor and whoever is supervising you during your course. Hey, I remember, those days, 50 years ago when I was in campus, life used to be. Can I tell you, my undergraduate alone took me 5 years because of the strikes. So those breaks just used to come anytime you have a break, you know. So students had the tendency of just something small, people are going in the streets, something small, people are out in the streets. And I guess that is what made university experience fun. Because again, when it's all peaceful and everything is flowing and there's not even one little drama, you get bored. So it's really nice when, you know, people make noise and you just have fun. Someone will call you, sit you down, and then you discuss the way forward, and then learning continues. But when you start learning, you learn for real. University of Nairobi is the best. Whenever you are in Canada as a student, and for as long as you'll be in Canada as a student, you need to be, or should I say you must be, study permit compliant. Because what happens is, when you get your study permit, you will be given some rules, which will be pasted there on your study permit. And it's a requirement that you follow all those rules and regulations, okay? So please do yourself a favor and follow those rules and regulations. To the latter, should you wish to graduate and earn your postgraduate work permit after 2 or 4 years of your studies. And the thing is, when you're starting your studies in Canada, you may be thinking, I'll just go study, and then I leave the country. You never know. Be diligent when you are taking your course. Apply for postgraduate work permit. Once you have it, you can go back home and consult with your family or your friends or whoever you feel comfortable consulting with. Then you make a decision whether you want to make use of your postgraduate work permit or not. And if you choose to stay back at home, no one will come and pull you with a string. You're coming back to Canada because you have a postgraduate work permit. You have to come and stay here. No, it's your own decision at the end of the day. So the favor you're going to do for yourself here is just making sure you follow all those rules and regulations, and then you apply for your postgraduate work permit. You never know. You may be thinking you don't want to stay on, but then after you finish, and then after, you know, mixing well with people, after making friends, you end up changing your mind and you decide, okay, it's not too bad after all. I can manage the cold. I'm settling here. So yeah, always purpose to do the right thing. Now let's talk about scheduled breaks versus authorized breaks. Very, very important. So what is scheduled breaks? A scheduled break is like, let's say you're going to school, okay? And you have a term, and then you have a break, maybe of 2 weeks, and then you start another term. So those dates are actually in the school calendar. That is what is called a scheduled break. So here's the catch. If you're a full-time student and you are on a scheduled break, a break which is on the school calendar, that way you'll be allowed to work full-time on your scheduled break. So I hope that comes out clearly, that a scheduled break is a break between your semesters and it appears on the school calendar. So you have a semester, you have break. If you're in school, you call them school holidays. You have a break and then you go back for the following semester. And those breaks are scheduled in your school calendar. That is what a scheduled break means. So as a student, you are now allowed to work full time when you are on a scheduled break. Any other time within the semester, because you'll be attending your classes full time, even if you have one course in a day, you cannot work. You are not allowed to work, but you can work part-time. So when the sessions are going on, you work part-time as a student and you can only do 20 hours per week. But when you are on a scheduled break, then you work full-time. You are legally allowed to work full-time. Please note this because it's important. If you make mistakes, whether you can even be deported. So I hope that is clear. Now let's talk about authorized breaks. Authorized breaks is like, for example, you're going through a semester and then something comes up. Maybe somebody back at home is unwell, or someone is getting married, or you are getting married, who knows? Okay, so you'll go to your university and ask for a break. And now it will be at the discretion of your university to allow you to take a break. And how long the break will take, your university will decide. Now, when you take an authorized break, that means you are not allowed to work full time. But let me go back a bit. Do we understand what authorized break is? So like I said, allow me to repeat. Maybe you're going to get married, or your sister back at home has gotten a child. You need to take a break and go spend time with them. So you'll go to your university and ask for a permission to take a break from the university. So then the university will authorize your break, meaning they will allow you to take a break. That is what is called authorized break. And remember this, when you are on authorized breaks, you are not allowed to work full time at all. And when time comes and you need to apply for your postgraduate work permit, you will need evidence that your university allowed you to take authorized breaks. So when your university authorizes you to take a break, make sure that all those letters, all the correspondence, you put your documents together for evidence when time comes for you to apply for your postgraduate work permit. It's as simple as that. So I hope that is super clear. This is what I need you guys to do. Watch the next video and I'll see you in the next one.